and the people will be asking them themselves. So we ask your permission then, so as not to waste any time, we'll go straight into it. But before inviting the questions from the floor, one theme which has been a theme for this event has been the title, same goal, different paths. Over our discussions and through all the practices we've done together, we feel it's same goal and same path. Yet nevertheless, when we actually read our scriptures, there's more ties reading the Tibetan scriptures and more understanding of the Pali canon. The language, when we talk about the goal, the ideals are described in different ways. Specifically, we all know that the Mahayana tradition will speak about the Bodhisattva ideal and at times even discourage the Arahat ideal. And this is very clear in the text. And in the Pali canon, we find the Buddha speaking very clearly of the Arahant ideal and explaining that this is for the welfare and happiness of all sentient beings. So how are we to understand this, given that the idea that you've spoken about, we all feel, is that it's one Buddhism, yet nevertheless, there's more and more people bringing this up. We get asked this a lot, and it's something which won't go away. The more we study each other's texts, we have to really understand this question, so we really feel Your Holiness is the person to answer it, and then we can move on to some other questions.
In Sanskrit tradition, and in Sanskrit scripture, the Panchaparamita Sutra so there see three yanas, Shavaka yana and Kasa, Buddha, and then Bodhisattva yana. So all these three yanas, you see, to some people, I think the three yanas is something completely different. That's a level of understanding. For example, the training to develop enthusiasm to achieve nirvana. That's the basis of Buddha Dharma. So Bodhisattva Yana must be based on that. Without some genuine sort of enthusiasm, liberate oneself, how can develop genuine sense of concern of liberation of other? So first, you should train the liberate oneself and try to develop enthusiasm. That we call minjun.
Renunciation.
Renunciation is the basis of Buddhicitta. Okay. So these are so like different sort of things, like steps. First step, second step, third step, like that. So I always, whenever I give teaching, I always say the Pali tradition, as yesterday I mentioned, the Pali tradition is the basis of Buddha Dharma. Then practice like Chajo Sutra.
The 37 limbs to enlightenment.
The philosophical view, the Four Noble Truths, and 12 Rings, Buddhism body. Then practical level, of course, the Kasa Jyoti.
37 Limbs to Enlightenment.
The first four from mindfulness. Mindfulness about the Kasa, ugliness of our body. That reduce attachment towards your own body and others' body. Then mindfulness, now this is too much, I feel too long, all of you know. So these, firstly, you see the shaping your own mind. Then through that way, once we realize there's so long of birth under control of ignorance, this is no genuine sort of joyfulness. Yesterday we discussed joyfulness. So therefore, training that way, then gradually it develop the desire or realize our final goal is nirvana. This one. So then the children are doing palanakya, the one who Thomas and Lim, you know, that the lalike.
Then when it comes to the actual implementation, then the rest of the 37 limbs to enlightenment comes into being.
Then the Shila practice also there. The palanakya, my sharing, that loves of doing.
And then in fact, when we talk about the Eight Noble Path, that summarizes the practice of the three trainings.
Oh. Then, once we develop the full conviction, the possibility of achievement of nirvana, then if you can extend the same sort of color, the enthusiasm, not oneself, but including yourself and others. So that's the cause of that. Do the devotion of it.
So this is the cause-effect chain.
So the Bhutsalaya or the Panchaparamita or these sort of traditions say the first Dharma wheel about Four Noble Truths. The second Dharma wheel is simply further explanation about what's Nirodha, the third noble truth, cessation of suffering. So further detailed explanation about Nirodha. Then another sort of category, which we usually call the third Dharma wheel, then explaining the mainly Kasara Chuti. Mark. Further sort of explanation about the mark. So all Buddhist teaching based on Four Noble Truths. And then obviously, the Bodhisattva's sort of vow, Trinu Namasum,
the three ethical practices,
or Bodhisattva's Shila, Nichu Dhamma Trinu.
First is restraining negative activities. Second is collecting virtuous qualities. And third is the morality for benefiting other sentient beings.
So in order to carry effective service to other, before that you must acquire some experience and knowledge. So that is second. In order to gain some spiritual experiences, you need Shila practice. So,
So in the case of the practice of restraining the negative emotions, as is explained in Bodhisattva, it is included in the morality of renunciation.
Of the Vinaya. Same, which is same, like that. So, that's a proper way. To follow, to practice. And then, also, it's like Nagarjuna clearly mentioned Nandu Durjalaya, one of the Ngeli Niyaris, Chani, Ngelis, Nirvanas, Chizamasubha.
And Nagarjuna, in fact, explains in his text is that in terms of our goal that is to be realized, we have primarily two goals, temporary goal and long-term goal. And when he talks about long-term goal, he is referring to Nirvana in general.
Moksha. Like that. Then, as far as sort of details of different views is concerned, then Nalanda tradition or Buddhist tradition divided four. Then further sort of subdivisions, I think at least 15, 20. Like the Vivasek school of thought divided 18, mainly four. So Swatantik also is 2. The Chitta Mantra also 2. And further sort of division, I think about 4 or about 5 or 6 like that. I myself not very sure. Then Madhyamaka philosophy, major sort of 2 groups, and further sort of because of that subdivisions more like that. These are different interpretation about Shunyata, about Anathema theory, like that. So therefore, if you look more holistic view, then no problem. Otherwise, you see, we have some. That's why I deliberately use the word Sanskrit tradition, Pali tradition, rather than Hinayana and Mahayana. And then, the Tibetan tradition, I usually use to describe Nalanda tradition. Nalanda tradition is combination, Pali tradition and Sanskrit tradition combined. So I think this sort of English kasa expression kasa, knowledge changes the kotosu kasa.
Little knowledge is dangerous. There's an English expression, little knowledge is dangerous.
So that's very true. So people who knows a little bit Pali or a little bit Karota, I mean, a little bit Buddhism and Tibetan Buddhism and like that and that, and within Tibetan Buddhism, due to lack of understanding, or the follower of Yellowhead sect say, Yellowhead sect is something nonsense. Some of the follower of Yellowhead sect or Redhead sect is nonsense. All these due to lack of fuller knowledge. Then also you see here, one time in Argentina, one sort of interfaith, or not only interfaith, some scientists also there, some sort of our meeting. At that meeting, one great Chilean scientist, he expressed his special field is quantum physics. So he mentioned at that meeting, his special field is quantum physics. But he should not develop attachment towards that particular field. He mentioned, he's not a religious person, I don't think. Certainly not Buddhist. So that, I think we should learn. So I often tell people, I am Buddhist, but I should not develop attachment towards Buddhism. Once we develop attachment, then your view becomes biased. Then you cannot see the objectively other thing. If we Buddhist too much attachment about Buddhism, then we cannot see the value of Christianity or Islam or Judaism or different Hinduism, like that. If you remain open-minded, look objectively, unbiased, well, then we can see good things like that. So that also, I think, one. And that also, you see, due to, I think, a lack of sort of understanding. That's my view. And then the word, there are some sort of text, like Kasanda, Chabakulu, Todigen.
Sutra
Alamkara. And they use, you see, Mahayana.
Sutra Alamkara.
Like that. So that's my view.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Your Holiness. It's obviously a huge.
Sounds a bit like a tour. Sounds a bit like a tour. Ah. I thought I could do it. Anything you want to add? Tell. Now in this room, of course, lay people and monk, you see, the monk should be superior. And then among monk, Tibetan monk, Thai monk, completely equal. And within monk community, you say, no sort of zoda. Someone is important, someone less. No, we all equal, except the age. When we have lunch, and I thought some maybe 80 years, beyond 80. So I asked anyone, and the main chair, you see, Kasoda, deserved for the oldest monk. Then I asked each one. Then finally, I'm oldest. So then I sit on the main chair. So there's linear rule like that. So otherwise, we're completely equal. So any suggestion?
Yeah, Holiness, thank you very much. We can think about that topic, and we'll bear in mind your answers as we study more about the Tibetan tradition. So then I'd like to invite the first question from the floor. That's Thiraphol. Do you want to stand up and ask your question?
เดี๋ยวจะขอเชิญคุณสุดาจันทสิริโชคแล้วก็คุณสุกัญญาสุขมงคลมาที่ด้านหน้าด้วยนะครับเชิญพี่คุณธีรพลครับ
Conflict seems to be present all over the worldEven in family and the workplace, anger is the source of aggression. Can His Holiness offer advice on how to sow the seeds of metta so that they truly bear fruit?
I'm on a single person. So these areworldwide sort of problem. So we have to make effort. So worldwide, right? So here, at least, you see, a few hundred people. Each one have the responsibility. So how to build a compassionate world? First, start from your own community. Then one community, 10 communities, 100, 1,000.Like that. Then basically, my own sort of today, certain views out of my own experiences as a result of meeting with a variety of people, then the secular approach is the best of, as I think that. Otherwise, I don't know. If I have some miracle power, then you can ask me, so one single person or through miracle power. I think as a sort of experiment, I think we have to test that, because of that lit fire, then hand go that fire, so if extinction is away, extinction. Then possibly, you see, that person can sort of extinguish fire of anger. Otherwise, it's impossible. Just effort.Teach people. What use? Anger. I also still develop anger sometimes. Then use, now we, everybody, I think human being, animal, but perhaps much less intelligence. We human being are the brain side intelligence. Anger, these are emotion side.So we human being is the only sort of species of mammals who can show some guide towards emotion through our intelligence, through or by our intelligence. So intelligence is the only answer I think both sides, to create more problem or to solve because of that this problem or to create more peace. This intelligence have the like because of sharp because of cheap, no need so cheap.
It's like a blade, you know, sharp, too sharp edges.
If our intelligence with combination of warm-heartedness, warm-heart, sense of responsibility, or sense of compassion, then our intelligence go positively. That, again, you see effect on our emotions. That's the only way. So training of mind means, see, with help of awareness, transform our emotion. That's the meaning of training of mind. Not just learning. Learning give us full of knowledge about reality, including health. And through that way, then we understand some of the emotions are very, very destructive of our health. Our peaceful family, peaceful community, peaceful humanity. So, intelligence tells us, oh, that's wrong. So, my own case, sometimes the immediate reaction from my mind is anger. And then the intelligence showed me, oh, there's no use. No any help to solve the problem. In fact, increasing the problem. So that awareness immediately reduced the intensity of anger. So, you also have great responsibility. Let us try, make common effort. Okay, isn't it? Next question.
Yes, and just before that, next question, just one a little follow-up to just Losak Kru and Patnam Nami. There was another question, Your Holiness, on this topic. Just if you could say a few words, a bit more personally, you yourself have over your lifetime had this very difficult situation, the Tibetan people. How have you managed to cope with this? And also the Tibetan people as a whole, how have they done
one
this?
One example, 10th March 2008, afternoon, 1 o'clock in India, I received one information from Lhasa. People in Lhasa, some area, already start demonstrations. Immediately I felt, oh, now that kind of activities bring more suppression, more Chinese possibly, violent suppression. So I really felt, they say, helpless, hopeless, sad, anguish, suffering. Then next few days, a few weeks, during my meditation, during my analytical meditation, I visualize some of these Chinese officials, and then develop some kind of sort of the sense of concern of their well-being and sort of sense of concern about their ignorance, so ignorance where? Ignorant of clash, you know? Clash. Oh? And then take their anger, visualize through imagination, take their sort of anger, their suspicion, their distrust, their hate, and give them my own sort of patience or compassion, forgiveness. That practice, of course, no help. Actual sort of event. But in order to keep my mind, peace of mind, calm mind, that kind of practice is immense benefit. Not only my own case, some Tibetan, I said a practitioner, scholar, I think in 1958, after Chinese read it, arrest many monks, and then about 100 they killed. So among them one Tibetan, one Ando, great scholar and great practitioner. On the spot, he going to be shot. He request the person who going to shoot him, please let me on prayer. That prayer, Tenzin Zulong presented.
And the prayer that he chanted was from a text called Offering to the Guru, which reads that, therefore I beseech
Guru Sumata, Buddha,
beseech the Lama, the kind Lama, with compassion. May I today be able to take upon myself all the sufferings and difficulties of sentient beings, and in lieu of that, may I be able to offer all the good things that I have done for the benefit of others.
Oh, after that prayer, then he indicated shot. Then another, that person still living, in Damsala. Now he says, I think 1995. He spent 18 years after 59, 18 years in Chinese Gulag. So in early 80, he had opportunity to come to India. I know him very well. So therefore, after he came to India, one occasion, we just casual talk. Then he mentioned, during 18 years, few occasions, he faced some danger. I thought maybe danger on his life. I asked, what kind of danger? He said, danger of losing compassion towards Chinese. He considered, losing compassion and develop anger is dangerous. He told me like that. So I think, as a result of practice these things, individual get immense benefit. In order to keep peace of mind and gain more inner strength, self-confidence. So that reduces fear. And then, some occasion, our scientific meeting, I'm meeting with scientists. I mentioned that. So there are some scientists, they say, really showing interest. So they want to meet these people. Some of these people. They want to interview. Then we arranged that after some scientists who involved that was the meeting, later told me they really sort of there is at my read. These people very much sort of traumatic sort of their life story. But in their emotion level, no sign of trauma like that. So these are examples as a result of practice of Dharma. Even I think secular way, I think there is possibility, even non-believer, once you fully understand what the peace of mind is, something very important for their health. And whenever they face problem, keep calm mind. The basis of calm mind is inner strength. Inner strength comes from compassion. So that's the logical, psychological system like that. So, you could handle this number, but you call it for truth. So therefore, you see there, and here, one American, my friend, I think yesterday I mentioned, because the number's name, Desert 但是我就开始做什么都做了我干 I'm back as I yesterday I did you see much problem is our own mental creation
thank you so much for that answer your holiness and so time is already moving very quickly we're almost at the end of this session we have many more questions so Sudha come and ask a question
My question is that, what is the responsibility of the laity with regard to the common problem for monks who misbehave?
Hmm? Oh. Yeah, that's right. Give me, give me. That's right. Cut it, cut it, cut it, cut it. Oh. Okay. No? Okay. Some occasion on meeting with Buddhist teachers from West, Western sort of Buddhist teachers. One occasion, I think maybe 10, 15 years ago, you see, they, some questioners, I mean, some questioners, some speakers, you see, raised the point. Some Zen master and also some Tibetan master, you see, they, or say the sex exploitation right now, or they raised this question. And in fact, one time I met one American. He told me his wife took by one Tibetan Lama. He became very, very angry. It is understandable. So, one hour meeting, is there some people who raised that question? Then I told them, now Buddha made clear our precepts where. That these people won't listen. The only thing is the public, because of that, media people or individual person. Must make public these things. Then they may pay some attention. Since they, disregard the Buddha sort of rule. So that's the only way. Make clear what monk, who monk, the monk, individual, in the monastery, make clear. That's not the only way. Otherwise, and as I mentioned earlier, it's a hypocrisy. Says Vinaya, 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 I'm doing something different. So the only thing is, we must make clear the public. That's only. Then another thing I would like to mention to you. In human history, say, I think, a few hundred thousand years ago, I don't think, I think even 100,000 years ago, I don't think the among humanity, the concept of a boss or concept of leader, everybody equal. Then gradually, farm system developed, and population increasing, and some sort of tea for these robbery rare. These things happen, some just injustice sort of activities happen. So then concept of leadership is developed. So at that time, no rule of education. No education. Therefore, in order to become leader, the physical strength is the key factor. So that start male dominance. Then gradually, education developed. So education brought more equal. Men, male and female. Sorry. So now, time comes we have to pay more attention, not only education, but education of warm-heartedness, education of compassion or affection.
In that,
in that respect, female biologically more sensitive about others' pain. Therefore, the effort to promote the value of compassion, the value of affection, female should take more active role regarding promotion of human affection. That in West, in America, on many occasions I expressed that. Now scientists also, some scientists, so they experiment. One male, one female, watching one sort of kind of movie picture, someone is passing through painful experiences. Then physical response, as well as emotional response from two persons, the female much more sort of sensitive like that. So that's a biological factor. So you should take more active role. Not necessarily be nuns. Oh, nice mother, kind mother, and tell other people like that. If you become mother without much sort of affection, that's I think worse. Very dangerous. I think I may say all those sort of female who married, I think should become like my mother. I can't say is my mother illiterate, uneducated, farmer lady, very, very kind heart. Whenever she saw some beggars, she always cheered. So, I think we, her children, I think never saw her face, angry face, never saw. So as a result, I think all of her children, I think raised that way. So more, so was the strong, because of the deep experience of the affection, right? affection, like that. So I often is telling half joke that too much kindness my mother little bit spoiled me. So when I was very young, 1 year, 2 years old, as a villager, you see, there's no other way, you see, because of that. Boom, somebody's asking about that.
There are many things like play things for the child.
Okay, how much?
Not available.
So only mother carry the child and go around like that. So I found she's sitting on my mother's shoulder. And then I'm quite bold, holding my mother's two ear. If I want to this side, if I want to go this side, my mother listened that. If not listen, then my shot. So my mother so kind, so my mother's kindness little spoiled this stupid son like that. So anyway, biologically, the female have some sort of greater potential, show affection to other. I think look, the nurses, many hospital nurses, you see, most cases female. And now, modern scientists, medical scientists also, you see, notice they're surrounding the patient more affectionate atmosphere is immense help to recover illness. Clear? So, in human life, education very important, but affection is more important than education. I think no scientists say better education, better health. No scientists say. Warm heartedness certainly should develop better health. They say that, isn't it? So our life starts with tremendous affection from our mother. So at the time of our death, surrounded by affectionate person, friendly, affectionate person, much happier. So whole life, human compassion, affection is the key factor for happy life.
Thank you, Your Holiness. We have so many more questions, but I've been told we're actually out of time for this whole session. Our timetable's changed. Maybe we can just ask one last question, which is more of a personal one. Because I think we do enjoy hearing you talk about yourself. Two more questions. We have one then on this subject then of women from Tanika. It is a very important subject and very right now relevant in Thailand. Your Holiness, question on women in Buddhism. Please, Tanika.
Your Holiness, as a Thai Buddhist woman, I have found that the role of women in Theravada Buddhism very limited and unequal to our male counterparts. With this frustration, I have found solace in the practice of Tibetan Buddhism, as I find it celebrates both the female and the male energy. Your Holiness, what are your thoughts on women's roles in Buddhism and its lack thereof in Theravada Buddhism? And if you have any advice for me?
I call him Vinaya. And for example, the tradition, Vinaya tradition, Mula Samasiddhi Vajan. So, in the text, it mentioned the Bhikshuni's vow must give by Bhikshuni. So, because of that, because of the physical sort of condition, Bhikshuni from India never sort of kasada, complete kasada, never present in Tibet. So that's why no proper Bhikshuni ordination happened. However, Buddha gave equal Bhikshu vow, Bhikshuni vow. And there's certain sort of the terms.
Fourfold Buddhist assembly. Fourfold Buddhist assembly.
Bhikshu, Bhikshuni, Kasaju, Upasika, and Upasiki there. Correct. So these four is the four. So you see, literature clearly mentioned where that four there. That's the Sanjay,
So in terms of demarcation from the point of view of Dharma, then wherever these four parishads are there, then that is treated as the central land.
So therefore, from that viewpoint, Tibet, not
So from that point of view, Tibet is not a central land.
Because no Bhikshunis. So we try in our last 40 years, I think more than 40 years, we try, you see, how to restore the Bhikshuni, or how to introduce Bhikshuni Vow. But then that's not beyond Dalai Lama's authority. That have to sort of decide by Sangha, not individual bhikshu. So some Westerners now you see some those Westerners, you see some Western or say the nuns, Buddhist, Tibetan Buddhist nuns, see they felt, or Dalai Lama, if Dalai Lama decide anything, all right, but Dalai Lama hesitate about that. So some criticism towards me. And then many occasions, I made clear, this is beyond Dalai Lama's control. This is Sangha. And also, you see, Sangha, also, you see, have to work these things according to the text, Vinaya text. So there are some sort of different interpretation, some wording in Vinaya. It looks a little sort of discrimination, right? Male, female. But we are trying. Actually, I think next month, right? Next month, we are going to have an international Sangha meeting. So I'm hoping, you see, discuss about these things. Some of the Chinese, one occasion, in Taiwan, I participated in one sort of meeting with some Chinese, bhikshus, who actually give bhikshu ni ordination. So he very much insists Tibetan Radha sort of narrow-minded. So now must change. So Tibet should introduce Bhikshu Nivas. Because he himself always give Bhikshu Nivas. The same meeting, another Chinese bhikshus, very respected, well known, Kasa Hong Min Kasa. Dao Han, a good scholar and great sort of bhikshu, wonderful bhikshu. So he expressed privately, not hurriedly decide. He mentioned that. So still this is limits of conversion. So difficult. So we have to thoroughly discuss. No question, Bhikshu Nivas, then Buddha give right. But the lineage, we have to, the way to perform the vow, we have to follow the Kasa, Vinaya sort of text. So, this is one thing. Now, what we can do is the education field. Then I can decide. So, over 40 years, most important bhikshu ni kasa bhikshu ni mara, nunneries among Tibetan, I decided they should start rigorous study like male, like monk. So now, after 30 years, around 30 years, I think yesterday I mentioned, now female kishis now coming. So that I can decide. So we implement it. As far as Bhikshu Nivas is concerned, beyond my control. So we have to discuss like that. So in any way, you see, you should not feel because of him, Goddess Tara. Goddess Tara, there's a story. Goddess Tara, when she developed buddhicitta or the altruism, which was in order to serve other sentient beings, once become Buddha. So once you see that, she developed then she should make her pledge. From now till Buddhahood, she's, her body will be female body. So sometimes I discard, she was the earliest feminist. So like that, same Buddha nature, Tathagata Garbha, everybody's mind, Tathagata Garbha, and intelligence, sometimes female intelligence, bigger, sharp, must develop determination, and enthusiasm, and courage, very important.
Thank you very much for this. Is that Sarawut? Okay, Sarawut has one question.
Hello. Your Holiness, my question is, has the Tibetan government in exile brought any Buddhist principles into its public policy? Could you please give us some examples? Thank you.
Firstly, see, we usually discuss our central secretary, sorry. Oh,
Central Tibetan Administration.
Oh, we not see. We do not use the word of exile government. Okay. So we right from the beginning, in early 60s, when our settlement started in this country, some NGO, some volunteer agencies, they say, advise us, fishery, poultry, pickery, it's quite economically quite useful, quite good. But then we right from the beginning, fishery, pickery, right from poultry, we not accept that. Then poultry, I don't know the exact word, poultry for eggs, not killing. Some settlement, some chicken, or some hens for eggs. Then, one occasion, I asked them, oh, some, you see, chickens there, or some hens there. So, for what? They say, for egg. Then after finished, that's the egg. Then what you handle that? No clear answer. Then I request them, if economy feels something highly necessary, then I am, so that, nothing to say. But if not so because of the necessity, then please close these, or what say,
the poultry farms
or poultry farm. Since then, no poultry. Of course, Tibetan, I think majority non-vegetarian, but in our settlement, no butcher, no poultry, fishery, and kasati.
Piggery
like that. So these we follow according to Buddhist teaching. And also, then non-violence. Right from the beginning, you see, our basis of them is based on Asoda, according to non-violent principle. Like that. On some occasion, CIA, basically, through their own mission, through their own agent, you see, they organize something. But Tibetan administration, Dharamsala, never support that. Like that.
Thank you, Your Holiness.
Yes?
So we are basically out of time. We just wanted to end with one last question, if we can ask His Holiness a personal one before inviting you to make the final address. Is we wrapped here?
อย่างขอเรียนเชิญคุณหมอวิรัตพันพาณิชย์ข้างหน้าครับ
ถ้าไม่มาก็ถามแทนก็ได้
Still, sometimes I would like to leave from here 2:30.
Yes.
So still, 45 minutes. Card. Oh, some picture. Okay.
Your Holiness, you have been the main contributor to the spread of the Buddhism worldwide. What has been the secret of your success? Thank you.
This all question. I think obviously one, I never tried to propagate Buddhism. So that's one factor for success. Then perhaps I think my sort of contact with scientists, that also I think one major sort of mistake contributed. Again, it's 40 years ago, when I, although it's my childhood, I have one question. According to Theravada, Theravada sort of Abhidhamma, the world is flat, isn't it? Isn't it? World flat.
Actually, I don't know.
And there in the center, Mount Meru. Abhidhamma Kosha Karika, this is clearly mentioned that. Mount Meru and Kasai. Zambudhirva and Phalanja Kasai. No, Phalanja is Kasai.
Gordaniya.
Chandamiya.
Kuru, Kuru.
Shandivabha.
Videha.
In any way, that's the Abhidhamma Kosha Karika mentioned. And quite a number of Buddhist teachers, you see, Kasoda, more or less Kasoda, admit that's the reality. Now I'm opposing that. As a result of sort of learning, the scientific sort of finding from space, deep space, picture, from room, picture, voice sound. No Mount Meru. Then here is a contradiction. Suppose night, because you see sun behind Mount Meru, so shadow of Mount Meru, you see, brings night here. So since we enjoy the shadow of the object, then that object must be seen. We can see it.
Must be seen.
But that, from space, or from aeroplane, go there, across the south to north, cross to Ubukasati.
Fly over.
Nobody see that. So therefore, the Buddhist logic clearly mentioned whether things are or exist or not, there are three categories.
You talk about three states of reality, the obvious manifest level, and the slightly hidden level, and completely hidden level.
So, Mount Meru, because shadow we sort of experience, so therefore must be belongs to the
obvious level, manifest level.
So then, Tong Yu Kachi, the Yeran on the Rosilla, Manana, the Melchior.
So if we claim something as being obvious and manifest and something that is directly perceivable, and then if you don't directly see it, then this proves the non existence of that object.
So therefore, I do not accept, I do not believe. Existence of Mount Meru. So, Abhidhamma Kosha some sort of description about the world. First, I think at that time, some sort of common sort of positive perception in this country, including some Hindus. So I think, just mentioned that, but these are not important. So science, since my childhood, I have a keen interest. Then, do you believe moon has its own light or not? What do you think? And size about moon and sun, not much differences. About Abhidhamma Kurika.
So there is not much difference in terms of measurement. Only one
Yojana. Right. Diameter
in terms of the diameter.
So therefore, these are we cannot accept literally. So in any way, in 40 years ago, I think early 70, I think early 70, I expressed this desire to, or desire on my wish, desire of dialogue with scientists in different fields of science. And one American lady who married with one Tibetan, that I think very much devoted Buddhist. One day, I just casually mentioned, I had this strong desire, meeting with scientists and discuss, dialogue. And she mentioned, that should be very, very cautious and it's dangerous. Science is killer of this thing. What do you think? German. Then I thought, no. To quotation the Buddha's own word, Buddha's teaching must be thorough investigation and experiment. So therefore, no danger. So I start talk or discuss with scientists four fields, cosmology, including Big Bang, these things, then neurobiology, yesterday I already mentioned. So therefore, I start, and if something wrong, according to scientific finding, then we have no problem. Yes?
From the ultimate thought of the Buddha, the purpose of the teaching, by taking all this into consideration, we can do the reflection. And then also a distinction is made between the intent of the author or the teacher and the intent of that particular scripture. There is a distinction between that also.
So there was no problem. So we start a serious dialogue with scientists. Then time passes among the many scientists. Interest about Buddhist, the science of mind is immense help to mortal scientists. The scientists who carry on research about the mind, that also now developed because of the health science, also now showing or recognize emotion is very important factor for our health. Then brain specialists. The more details of research about brain activities, very close connection, emotion and brain cells. So sometimes it's quite obvious, they found through their experiment the through training of mind, actually some change in our brain perception.
There's a change that takes place in the brain. Now they talk about the brain plasticity, the brain's capacity to adapt and change.
Actually, it's changing. So now some very broad-minded scientists now already now find or I think accept the existence of mind, emotion, these things. One by one, German scientist, physicist, his name I always remember quite easily, Wolf Singer. So Wolf Singer means something. Oh, like that. So I remember his name quite clearly, Wolf Singer. So you see, brain specialist. One hour meeting, he draws. Painting red. He draws big picture. He say, brain. No place of central authority. Then he mentioned whether he believe or not. I don't know. Certainly not Buddhist. And at the meeting, you see, he showed that picture. The picture of that sort of drawing red. Drawing. He mentioned, according scientific brain specialist of research finding, no place of central authority. So Buddhist question of anathema is very fit according to that finding. Soul theory, no place according to that finding, he mentioned like that. So therefore, you see the number of scientists now really show year by year increasing the interest about Buddhist psychology. Rapidly, and Buddhist concept about Pratisamubandha. Some great scientists, famous scientists, you see, very fond, you see, that concept. Everything interdependent, interconnected, no independent action. Like that. We Buddhists, very, very helpful to learn particles about light. All these things. And the other day, I was told that I was told that That din yeding yuki jumei kan lo gaji. That jumei chal shi dekudu liya. Nune, hai zi an da scientist ta ni jik light, jik air, ni mungu jik shi ashti ba. In any way, you see, they're learning from their finding. Very helpful. So combination, scientific sort of research and ancient Buddhist thought, Buddhist concept, is it combined. Some kind of synthesize. It's very, very helpful. That, I think, there's a little bit of presumptuous, right? Presumptuous. I think I may take a little critic, right? A critic. I think I start with science and actually, I never say Buddhism. I only say modern science and Buddhist science, some. do you I think from West, do you give me some sort of credit about that?
We do give Your Holiness great credit for that. So Mo Ban Cha, thank you very much. Your Holiness, we'd like to invite you to say some words.
Now time is going on. During the whole 2 days that Your Holiness give our opportunity to learn quite a lot, and so many things is going on to be worked out. May I request Your Holiness to give us the closing remarks. We do have about 10 to 15 minutes for Your Holiness for closing remarks. After that, and after that,
closing remark, zero. Nothing. We already had serious discussions. This is not sort of formal meeting. A formal meeting, then I have to find some nice words and close remark. But I don't think this is necessary. Actually, so I was very, very sort of impressed, very much impressed to see you. I think very, very eager, you see, to discuss today. Very good. And now, I think Buddhism, basically, Buddha's sort of teaching is very realistic, very flexible. So, we take that principle, and now 21st century, in many fields, the reality changes. Our Buddhism have the ability to adopt well, to adapt new reality. So, we Buddhists, of course, Vinaya rule, we have to follow. As far as Vinaya rule is concerned, we must be conservative, right? Conservative. Some other Buddhist thought, you see, according to reality, new way to look, finding the reality, we must accept that. No problem. So therefore, Buddhism has this ability to go with time. At time, modern time, the science, so to say, the very rapidly because they're developing. So I think once Einstein was mentioned, Buddhism can go with science. That's very true. So I think we should think open-minded and pursue realistically. So that I want to share with you without losing our principle. Our principle is no danger. Everybody sort of accept warm heartedness and concept of Paticca-samuppada. Everybody agree that. Scientists also fully agree that. So that's the basis of two things. Viewpoint, Paticca-samuppada. The practice is concerned, non-violence, ahimsa, non-violence, a compassion. Okay. So in order to catch our time, not sufficient, just to remain, or some sort of hermit is necessary. Forest monk like that, you also forest rock, highly sort of appreciate. But meantime, we must study science or modern these things. These things are, I think, very, very important. Without knowing these things, then we can sort of adapt to a new reality. That's important. So that's all. Thank you. So now, I think 2 days, or as a result of our do this meeting. Now we all just sort of finalize some committee or something, some group of people who carry this work continuously. So that's wonderful. So I think concrete result from our this meeting. Wonderful. Thank you.
May I ask Venerable Ajahn Anek, accompanied by Sri Panyo Bhikkhu Prakhun and Ong Dalai Lama. Ratana Nimon, please.